Hello, friends, and welcome back to a tournament of lies. I'm Daniel Dwyer, joined by Mr. Dennis Walsh in Waterford, Ireland. How are you doing, Dennis?
I'm good, all good. Nothing's changed from last week because, as you know, we are recording this straight after last week. So,
what do you think about Sparkosoft, Dennis?
I think they've stuck with us over the last week. It's been a tumultuous week, but they've stuck with us. There's been a pretty big backlash online, as we all know. But
we're not going to talk about the controversy. The controversy is too much, but they're still here. Hopefully, one day our Patreon will make it so that we can get rid of that logo on the screen. James O'Connor in Hollywood, how you doing, my friend?
Not too bad. I'm going to keep up the theater of the mind and say I had an amazing week last week. Two marathons down. Played a lot of video games. That was really good. Finished a novel. Writing, not reading. And it's interesting to see that Trump won. So good to know. Nice to see. Hello, everyone in the future. Enjoy yourself.
Can't believe they sprung that election.
Yeah.
Amazing. If you're listening to this for the first time, I mean, just go back and listen to the first episode, you big weirdo. Don't start on the second one. But if you are, this is the podcast where three friends scattered around the world, three intercontinental champions, if you will. There you go. We try and succeed in rating every single video game ever made in objective quality, top to bottom. The current winner is Super Meat Boy. It's leading Mario Strikers Charged in second and Star Wars Episode 1 Pod Racer in third. The worst game on our list right now is Unreal Championship 2, The Liandry Conflict. We take submissions via a tournament of lies at gmail.com. I said VA, that's not a word. Via, and also probably via the YouTube comments as well. We'll dip in there. If there's any game that we don't know enough about, it goes into our purgatory of lies, which is a pot through which myself, Denis, and James will pick out games and play them periodically so we can talk about them. And we also have a parole board, so if there's enough people who are vocal about a game being in the wrong position, perhaps you think City of Heroes should be lower than Angry Birds, eventually we will get around to some of those games as well. So let us know how you feel about that in the comments below and in the emails as well. All right, shall we dump straight into it, gentlemen?
Yep, let's do it.
Anything I haven't covered there in our little speedy intro? I guess Sunset Overdrive's already in Purgatory, and I have to play that.
Maybe, yeah, mention what we're hopefully going to play. And I suppose for any listeners who've sent in lists and maybe were like, hey, they didn't talk about our list. Like, the lists are still there. There's no, this week's list, and if you weren't chosen, you're gone, kind of. It's just, we'll get around to it eventually, hopefully. Maybe not.
Yes, we have a bunch of them here. There's 200, I think, submissions on this initial list. Did a little bit of vetting for stuff that we know we hadn't played anything of, but otherwise we're basically randomizing through that list and attempting to pick out games. So if there's any games, we only had one game last week that went into Purgatory, which is good, but maybe we'll have some more this week. Okay, here we go. I'm going to roll the dice. I've already rolled the dice actually on this one. This one is from Benjamin Hope, who submits a themed list. Actually, this is our first themed list we've had. First game in here is Spyro the Dragon.
Okay.
Which was the PlayStation 1. I remember playing this when I was maybe 14 or something, I feel like.
Around there. Younger?
Yeah, definitely. 98. I'd say 97, 98.
98. Okay, yeah. So, yeah, you're right. It came out in 1998.
10,
so
11, kind of 12.
Yeah, I was 12. Yeah, so this, it's first game spawned a bunch of, sequels after the fact. This was Mark Cerny's game, the Sony dude. He's a real interesting dude if you interview him. He's a bit of a weirdo. Insomniac Games. Now it exists only in the form of Skylanders, which was originally a Spyro spin-off. Yeah, which is nuts. But that original game, I remember thinking it was for children and then playing it and then actually really enjoying it quite a lot.
Right. Can somebody... I should have done this. This should have been something I did. But where does this chronologically compare to Super Mario 64? Because that's something that's going to be... compared to, and I need to know which came out first.
Post, 2 years after, maybe three. Actually, no, when did Super Mario 64 come out? Like, 95, 96?
96, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. 2 years after it.
So I'm just trying, because I didn't feel like this was, by any means, my first kind of 3D platformer in what we considered in the modern time. But it was really good. It was gorgeous for its time. It was technically marvelous. The character was pretty enjoyable, something that Sony haven't done a great job of in a long time for games on a console. So I suppose, I don't know. It's a pretty great game.
Yeah, it came out 2 years after Spyro as well, which was the same year as Mario 64. So you're right, like the 3D platforming world was maybe not well-trodden ground, but it had been trodden on a little bit.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
There was something about Spyro, I think, because it was a lot of... I guess the mechanic that they had in Spyro that wasn't in anything else was the gliding aspect.
Yeah, especially the glide, yeah.
Yeah, so you were like, modern platforms was very much about like mantling up on things and like jumping from part to part. But there was this element in Spyro where you'd see a platform quite far away and you'd need to like kind of judge, oh, will I be able to make that? And there was lots of, I remember there was lots of like air columns rushing up, which you could sort of like catch onto and catch a wave and or catch a breeze and sort of get some more height. And then the one thing I do actually remember not liking about Spyro was in between every couple of levels they had these, you know, parts where you were racing through rings floating in the air, and if you didn't get them in the right order, like, I remember repeating those over and over quite a lot actually. Yeah, I liked the first Spyro. Then they sort of grew that character. He became like a tween, I think, in later games, and then became a teenager and eventually
tried to darken it up at some point.
Yeah, the gritty real reboot of Spyro the Bloody Dragon.
Yeah, Spyro with a cigarette in his mouth. Was hanging out with the wrong crowd, motorcycle jacket on. Yeah,
Spyro the Dragon forever.
So I don't know. I mean, I guess wasn't the whole concept like Spyro's trying. I mean, it followed the platformer thing. Did it have an open world to get to levels, or was it kind of like in succession?
I can't remember. You're right. I remember the first level was. I think the levels were just really big, and I think you might have gone backwards in them. Like, I don't necessarily think they were linear.
Yeah, yeah. Because that's. I don't know. I just sort of felt like. I definitely feel that, like, again, this is just from people viewing it. I probably, if I did play any Spyro, it was not enough to really put any time to it.
Mm.
But seeing friends playing and all the rest of it, I feel that, like, now and again, and especially with Sony, once they get a formula, they make it every which way they can. And I think there's, like, several platformers that they had. And Spyro was the next sort of like, okay, here's a character. Now, as you said, you played it in stuff like the glide, the fire attack, and certain mission parts to it was probably very much to its own. But I know my initial thing was, I was like, there's better out there, or there had been predecessors that were better.
Yeah, I mean, like, after the fact, there was the sort of Jack and Daxter.
Yeah,
the stuff
Ratchet and Clank.
Sony did Ratchet and Clank as well. So, yeah, they've always sort of attempted to have that marquee 3D platform. Actually... this is a themed list, and I feel almost like we need to talk about the next one to talk about where Spyro lives.
Okay.
So the next one that's mentioned on Benjamin's list is actually Crash Bandicoot from 1996, the sort of de facto mascot of the PlayStation 1.
I would say, and a classic straight away.
Absolutely.
Ooga Booga.
Yeah. Oh, man. So good. Even just, I mean, again, like, I think even different... like Crash Bandicoot, like, is a perfect example. I feel like Spyro was, my impression, Spyro was almost like taking what Crash Bandicoot had, the dynamics to it, and then we're like, okay, well, now here's a dragon character and put in the levels. But I mean, just even, just it was simple, but even like the level selection menus in Crash was fantastic. The design was good. Even like that initial, like, really, because to think, even with Mario 64, like, where, like, those games sort of place where, like, not a year before you're playing 2D left right side scrollers, and then suddenly it's like 3D. It's like it is adding a third dimension. You're completely thrown off.
Like, I mean, yeah, when I go back and play Crash now, it's not particularly fun. It's essentially an endless runner where you have to, like, jump at the right time.
Yeah.
But at the time, it was, like, mind blowing.
Oh, yeah. And it was just even just like the destruction. He's like, he was part Tasmanian Devil, he was part. Like the chasing, yeah.
It was all Bandicoots.
All Bandicoots. but no, I mean, yeah, the characters, the life system where it's the little mask at the side, the villain. Like, there's just like. Crash did everything right.
I think kind of Spyro is to, like, say, Super Mario. I think, you know, there's very clear parallels between Donkey Kong and Crash Bandicoot. Now, Crash Bandicoot was a development that, like, say, okay, Super Mario had already been moved into the 3D realm in Super Mario 64, whereas Donkey Kong 64 hadn't come out, I would say, at this point. I'd say Crash Bandicoot predates it by a couple of years, and also Donkey Kong 64 wasn't a great game. That's kind of where they should have gone, that kind of immediately entertaining, very bombastic, just like, you know, bombards you with just entertainment straight away. Crash Bandicoot kind of killed it. And I think, like, I remember, you know, we're quite young at that point on the playground. That was the one that when somebody would kind of tell me, oh, PlayStation's better because that's Crash Bandicoot, that I couldn't really retort anything because it was so great and I loved it. So, super game. And I think, yeah, if you're putting those two up against each other, I think there's a fairly clear winner in Crash Bandicoot. But, you know, maybe an aficionado who's played both of them a lot more might disagree.
I mean, it's hard to sort of talk about Spyro without mentioning Crash. So, in a way, the list is sort of already chosen Crash as the higher one. I think I agree with you that wherever these end up on the list, the Crash should be higher than Spyro. What do you think, James?
I would almost, as of this point, as the list, I would almost put Crash Bandicoot number one.
Oh!
I would almost put it ahead of people. I don't know, I think, and again, as a slight aside, I feel like really the PlayStation 1 was the game of twos. Like, it's really the sequels of all those games that really set the mark. So maybe I'm going a little too high, because in my mind, I played, you know, Crash Bandicoot played to death, but I played Crash 2 first, I believe. And Crash 2, I think, is even a better game.
Yeah, it came out the following year.
Yeah, so maybe that's what we're getting way off sort of to a side here, but like really, it was Tomb Raider 2, it was Crash Bandicoot 2. There's a few other sequel games that like completely set the PlayStation.
Don't even talk to me about Tomb Raider 2 being better than Tomb Raider 1. So.
It's so good. It was the one that said it. Okay,
hey, I personally will have to veto that. I don't know if we have a veto system, but I'm vetoing Crash Bandicoot going number one. I can nearly accept it at number two, but I struggle with it going above Mario Strikers Charge as well. But it's in that area for sure. It's definitely in the debate in that top, somewhere in the top three. It's a 1, 2, or 3.
Can we all agree that it's better than Star Wars Pod Racer?
Yes.
Okay.
And more important as well, but.
Yeah, I'm thinking third. I'm thinking behind Mario Strikers Charge. So the reason for this is, I think, Crash Bandicoot is a game that is almost universally accepted as being good by default because of the impact it had, and it's sort of universally loved. And like, it has that aspect that you were referring to, where people on the schoolyard were like, "Yeah, it's a great game," just almost without even knowing all that much about it. And it is a great game, but it has an easy ride. Whereas Mario Strikers Charge is on the complete opposite end of that spectrum, where like nobody's played it, nobody really knows how great it is, and the people who have played it like adore it. So I kind of feel like I want to fight for the underdog in this situation, and I want Mario Strikers Charge to be higher than Crash Bandicoot. So maybe it's more of a desire than a reality thing. I don't know.
I'm happy with that. I don't know if James is, but I suppose you've kind of sewn your own bed here, as the saying goes, which is that, you know, you've already said that Crash Bandicoot 2 is a better game. So that's
don't get me wrong, I could fully be fueled and living off nostalgia right now.
That's fine. That's what we're doing.
Yes. So that's so, I can live with it being number three with the two games that are ahead of it.
But then Spyro, I feel, isn't too much further down. I probably feel it goes right in behind Podracer, because like City of Heroes is still pretty niche at the end of the day. Yeah, I had a lot of fun with it. We all know people who've played it a little bit, but like it wasn't a genre-defining game. Spyro is a genre-defining game. Not a singular, it's not the 3D platformer, but it was one of the early triumphs in that genre for sure.
Yeah.
No? Oh. Okay, I think I'm getting a lot of pushback here.
No, it's definitely better than Angry Birds. So again, the argument comes to go above or below City Heroes.
You're the arbiter here. For reasons unknown.
No, I'm not. You can veto anything you want, apparently.
That's my special power. We all get special powers. That's a new thing, folks. Special powers.
What's James's?
I can veto things. Beard.
Beard, yeah. Any game with a beard, you can put in number one. I think what we do here is we say which game did more for the genre it was in. Did City of Heroes leave a lasting impression in the world of MMO games more than Spyro left a lasting impression in the world of 3D platforms? At least that's where my brain sort of tries to figure this particular quandary out.
I'd row in on the side of Spyro there. I think City of Heroes, there's been dozens of games like it before and after EverQuest, you know, Guild Wars. They're all much of a muchness in terms of mechanics. It was pretty cool, and it's one of the few of those that like put a MMO in a different setting, because we're all used to orcs and goblins and what have you. I don't know, am I defeating my own argument here? Possibly. But Spyro was, I think it was a formative game in that genre. And I think maybe we have to consider how big that genre is. Whereas MMOs, like being formative in MMOs doesn't mean you're like, you're not affecting every gamer, because there's so many, there's millions of gamers who will never play an MMO.
The sort of the buy-in for a company on the MMO space is so high that even the bad MMO, or the normal MMO games are of a certain quality, whereas 3D platformer sort of runs the gambit from like super good to atrocious.
But every person who's had a console more or less has very likely played some sort of 3D adventure game. And in fairness, here's another thing. That's what those MMOs all are. They're just massive multiplayer online 3D adventure games. So I don't know what that means. Nothing.
Okay. I mean, something about it just feels wrong putting Spyro above City of Heroes, but when you chew it out, it kind of does feel like it's a little bit more significant in that respect.
Like, I'm not going to veto this, so I'm happy for it to go either side of City of Heroes. It's in that ballpark.
Yeah.
I think maybe the both of you are leaning towards having it below City of Heroes, or I don't know what's going on there.
What do you think? What do you think, James?
Yeah, I mean, Dennis is the one who's played City Heroes. He doesn't know that. I think maybe we're sort of sticking to the list where we have like this sort of nice spread right now of like different game genres. But it's early days, so I think both games are going to be way down the list in a few weeks.
Good point.
So I'm going to say it goes a... I think Spyro has had more of an impact in general than City Heroes.
Okay. There you have it.
And I put it ahead of that.
Spyro Dragons, number 5. It's in the top 5 games of all... Sorry, yes it is. Top 5 games of all time. Star Wars Pod Racer splitting our two most recent entries from Mr. Benjamin Hope. But he had one more game on his list, which we are now going to talk about. I have not played this. I have a feeling you might have, Dennis, because you were the owner of a particularly strange console.
Okay.
So this game is the original Gex.
On 3DO.
Yes. I'm guessing. Gex was what's written down here.
Okay. I think it was on the Super Nintendo 2, though.
Oh, was it really?
No, Gex was... Just Gex, not Gex 3D.
Yes.
So it was on the PlayStation as well. There was a 2D platform one, so it was on the original PlayStation.
Yeah, that's what I think.
And Saturn.
Yes, this is before Enter the Gecko with the weird...
Gex 3D.
Yeah, Gex 3D stuff.
It's a shame he didn't write that and that's the game, because that game I would put number one.
God.
I'd put it ahead of... No, that one is actually a fantastic game. Gex, the 2D one, I played.
Yeah, I played quite a bit. There was a time in my life, and maybe in other people's lives, where you would rent a console.
Yes.
And it would come in like an aluminium case, and you'd rent it for the weekend, It was like your life. And... I used to, so we had a PlayStation, but sometimes I would, sorry, we had a Nintendo at home, but sometimes I would rent a PlayStation, and I would nearly always rent Gex with it.
Oh, nice.
And I loved it. But we had a 3DO as well, so a Panasonic 3DO. Did I have it? So thinking back on my story, we probably didn't have it on 3DO. But it was a game that I really loved. I suppose we, funnily enough, we kind of mentioned with Spyro that it had like, we were joking about a gritty reboot, but this was probably one of those first games that was kind of childish to look at, but tried to have a humor that maybe spoke to adults a bit as well. I thought it's definitely not a technically impressive game. And I don't even mean technically as in sound and visuals. I mean, technically, as in, like, you know, it doesn't play like Super Meat Boy or Super Mario, where it's really hard or anything. You just kind of play through it, and you will get through it. It's not difficult.
Where does it lie in the sort of... So it came out in 1995, so that's a year after Earthworm Jim, which kind of felt like one of the most, you know, I don't know, like a red letter day for sort of that style of 2D platformer, which was kind of more difficult than what, you know, we were used to with games like Sonic and stuff, and had a little bit more of a adulty or like teenage humor to it. Where does it lie with, like, did you play Earthworm Jim?
I did, and yeah, I don't think it would sit with Earthworm Jim. Earthworm Jim is a super game and extremely, extremely difficult, and looked great for the time for sure. Yeah, I don't think it's overly comparable in terms of quality.
I had no idea that we were just thinking. You were saying Earthworm Jim. I know Dave Perry designed that, who's a Northern Irish game developer who like founded Shiny and all that stuff. I didn't know Crystal Dynamics were the ones who made Gex. So they later went on to make, well, they took over Tomb Raider, but they also made the Legacy of Kain series, I think.
Mm. Oh, wow.
And they worked on those with whoever the, what was the name of it? Silicon Knights, I think. I think they did that. So they ended up making a bunch of really great games. But so where do you think this lies for you, Dennis? What sort of area are we talking about here?
Like, yeah, I don't know. Am I getting into the realms of revisionism? But I don't think it's a hugely formative game when it comes to its genre. I don't, like, it was fun, and, like, you know, I'm kind of making fun of the younger me who was renting this game far too often. But it wasn't that good. It was just a game that was out at the time. Yeah, I don't think it goes in that area we were talking about already. I think it drops down a little bit. Then, yeah, we go back to the argument, do we, these casual games like Angry Birds, do we think it's even in that kind of neck of the woods? I don't know.
I mean, it's hard to say, because, I mean, again, as you said, like, 95, Earthworm Jim, Donkey Kong Country are out.
Right.
And then Gex is still sort of there. Gex almost, like, from what I remember the first Gex, it almost, like, falls into that weird, like, Bubsy the Bobcat. Like, it is a platformer. There might be a dynamic I've completely blanked and forgotten about.
It's like another also ran in a very like fat genre. Is that what you're saying?
Yeah, kind of. Like, I mean, I think that was a whole thing where it was almost, I mean, clearly one boy in Waterford rented it several times to get to his house. But no, outside of that, I would have said, like, I would have almost forgotten about, like, Gex was one of those things where I feel like Gex 3D, suddenly people go like, oh wait, 3D, like, there's two more of these games. Well, again, at least for me, maybe I'm just projecting.
Yeah, but, like, I think it's probably more comparable to things like Prince of Persia and maybe Pitfall and things like that. And I don't think it, even to those classics, which it, you know, it came out a lot long time after, I don't think it's particularly something I'd overly want to play above them. I don't think it's a superb game.
Is it worse than a Unreal Tournament Championship 2, the Leandri conflict?
No, that's
not a better name.
That's not a bad game. That's not a bad game.
I don't think Gex is a bad game.
Yeah.
That's probably, we still haven't, certainly haven't gotten like a outright bad game yet. I think probably something that shoots Unreal Championship Tournament, whatever the hell it's called, is that it seemingly didn't suit its console. It didn't suit its platform at the time. You know, controllers were probably a bit hammy for trying to play a super, super, like, quick shooter game. Yeah, it's in that neck of the woods.
Specifically, what part of this neck of the woods?
I think it probably goes above Unreal Championship. And again, it's not to say that Unreal Championship is dreadful. It's just that it wasn't great.
Okay, but better than Excitebike.
Excitebike, I'd have above Gex.
You'd have your
Excitebike. Oh, sorry. Yeah.
Okay.
Does anybody else agree? Care? I don't know.
Yeah. Okay. That works. That works well. We'll stick it in there. Gex is the second worst game ever made, according to our Tournament of Lies. Thank you so much to Benjamin Hope for sending those in. All right. Let me roll the dice. Let me do the magic over here. Gentlemen, what have you been playing this week, actually, while I figure out what's next on our list? Dennis.
Since our last podcast, mostly just playing Dota. Yeah, yeah, had a few too, very frustrating losses. It's you know, it's that kind of game. But, you know, you get one win for every five losses and you feel good about yourself. That's all that matters.
I have our next three games.
Yeah, let's do it.
Gentlemen, the first one, this is from BigSar89, who is presumably 27... years old and feeling real good about it. So maybe these games reflect a 27-year-old's perspective on video games. Three very different games. We're starting off with, I remember playing this a good bit at a very particular time and then never playing it again. Do you guys remember Hellgate London?
Oh, Yes.
Let me look
do
it
I? I do. Oh, I'm kind of mixing up with Painkiller.
Okay, actually, it Painkiller, didn't look it? All that different in terms of art style, I'll say that.
I think the box art is probably quite similar as well.
So the game could be played in either third or first person, I remember. Okay. And it was basically a attempt to make a first/third person action-based MMO, but all that action was predominantly like instanced in a way that like kind of Guild Wars was, less so than World of Warcraft, which had its whole, basically everyone was like thousands of people on the same server. It came out in 2007.
Oh wow.
It's dead now. It died, I think, around 2010 or something when the company flagship went bust. So it never really sort of... I remember hearing about it for years. I remember they were like, Hellgate London's going to come out, and it's all about being like... I used to fight in underground swamps, like in the tube stations probably and stuff. And it was kind of like... You know what it was like, actually? Was what were the name of those? Not the Stalker games, the other ones. The other ones that are set in Poland. Metro. It's got that kind of similar weird aesthetic and sort of creepy... what the fuck is going on down in these underground caves kind of thing. But you could play with a bunch of people and you could like party up and do all that sort of stuff. And I had one or two friends who were kind of into it and played it a bunch. It was like, you know, the way you have, you know, your friend who's into that weird band that no one else like, but they're like really, really into it.
Sure.
And like no one else, but then they find someone else who's like also into that weird band, and then suddenly they're like best friends, even though they've nothing else in common. Like, that's kind of what Hellgate London was. It was like, why did you pick that? It was like in Ireland when we got to pick whatever football team we supported, right? Or like your dad supported whatever and you support as well. Like, I picked Arsenal for it. It's like, you know, you had that one friend. Actually, who do you support, James?
Blackburn Rovers.
Yeah, so exactly.
For life.
You were...
Oh, no, 100%. You were, like, no, a friend of mine was like, I support Blackburn Rovers. And I was like, oh, cool, me too. never looked back.
Right, so Hellgate London is the Blackburn Rovers of video games, basically. It's like, why anyone would pick this is beyond me, but... statistically, everyone does. Have you guys seen much of this at all? We're sort of shooting in the
I probably remember more so the hype around it than necessarily the game itself. I didn't play it. I remember it being a big deal when it came out. I guess it kind of got lost in the shuffle for me. I can't speak to its quality.
Yeah, it was a... There was like a subscription element to it, but I don't think you needed necessarily to buy into it. It was like a hack and slash, it was difficult. It was kind of, I don't want to say Dark Souls because everyone compares everything to Dark Souls, but there was a sort of a, like the instances had a sort of a roguelike element to them. And there was some sort of subscription mode that had PvP, I think, but I think they had like a two-tier system where there was a base game that was, you could sort of explore on your own, but then they had this other online component. Like I said, there was more Guild Wars-y in it, in that, you know, you could tell when you were in the online part of the game and when you weren't. You know what it sounds like, actually, is Destiny. It's basically Destiny that came out in 2007. Hellgate London is. You could play on your own, you can solo, you can play in first person. It's shooting things coming at you, and then you could also party up inside these instances. So it's basically Destiny that came out in 2007. So okay. It's shit.
Yeah.
Okay.
So Destiny came out in 2014. Isn't that good?
Yeah, I don't think there's any fans of Destiny on this podcast. But...
I actually played a load of it.
Kind oh, really?
It. We'll talk about it another time. Okay, hopefully. Fair enough. Maybe not.
So am I sort of guiding where this is landing then, I'm assuming? Okay.
I do have to wonder as well, though, Dennis, are you playing Destiny because... the alternative is you're like in a room with a pile of rocks playing together.
It's either that or Dota.
Dota, and you're like, oh, well, do I do with this PS4? Throw rocks at it. Yeah, or Destiny.
Destiny is like you throw rocks, but every once in a while, one of the rocks is made of chocolate.
James, so. Stop trying to build your brand.
Fucking Sparkosoft.
So, where are you feeling? How are you feeling about this game?
I mean, bottom half anyway. Like, looking around the sort of... Gex Excite Bike area.
Sure.
Yeah.
I don't.
Is it? Well, here it is. Like, does Unreal Championship 2 at least have the benefit of good heritage to put itself off the bottom list, pull it up by the bootstraps, and we sort of like take sympathy and go, at the end of the day, it is an Unreal game. yeah, it's a console that sort of probably couldn't do it really right, and it was like an alternative at a time when they hadn't really perfected FPSs on a console, and give it a little bit of a pardon.
Yeah.
And does this go to the bottom of the list?
I feel really bad that this would go at the bottom of the list. It was one of these games that I think people, you know, the way when a game or when anything isn't like, it's not really that great, but you can see like they really tried and it had
the potential. Yeah,
and I think there was like people remarked on how good like the setting and story was, but perhaps the like it didn't come together in a way that games like Rocket League, right? Rocket League comes together in a way that it works, but it's a super acrobatic whatever car game was kind of the same ingredients, but it didn't gel in the way that Rocket League did, and it wasn't the right time and place. I feel like that's where Hellgate London is. So it's not a bad game, but I kind of want to put it above Unreal, because Unreal is like a console spin-off of a good game.
I like that. I like the fact that you could say, oh, well, no, yeah, because like, what you're saying is pretty much like the execution maybe went a little wrong, but the ideas were there. And then Unreal Championship is like, you know, arguably just another rehash.
Yeah, Unreal. So, like, I would like, hopefully, for Unreal Tournament 2003 to be a different entry on this. Unreal Championship 2 feels like a copy and paste of a much better game, whereas Hellgate, I'd put it above Unreal. I'm guessing it's not getting above Gex. Yeah, I don't think it deserves to get above Gex either.
Okay, I'm happy with that.
Okay, that was a weird one. Thank you so much for that one. The next one, I mean, this is going to be very interesting for the top, probably. Super Mario World.
Oh, number one. I don't even need to talk about it.
Just having super name is enough to get you to death anyway.
Exactly. Super Mario, I mean, you guys just pull up a chair. Just sit down. Because, like, this Super Mario World is the greatest game ever made. You can, first of all, like, it is the darling of Nintendo system, which was the Super Nintendo. It came out in 1991. It is still beautiful. There's something about whichever way they took advantage of every single 16 bits that they had to them. And they just made a game that just went on top of Super Mario 3, which in turn was Super Mario Brothers. Mm. Where to start? You start off in a world. The map is fantastic. The secrets that are hidden around the map are fantastic. Like the world you can go to, the shortcuts, the hidden key and locks in levels. The boss fights, the power-ups, the fact that you could store a power-up, the fact that Yoshi came in, the fact that there's several Yoshis, the fact there's about 100, I think total is like 112 levels, and you get them all. And it is just, I mean, the spinning move, like everything a Mario game should be is Super Mario World. The biggest crime I feel against Super Mario World is that it never really got, with all the new Super Mario Bros., And sort of the spin-off games on the DS and the Wii and the Wii U, they've always sort of leaned more to Super Mario 3.
Mm.
And I've always felt like they sort of do the world map, but it's more of a Mario 3 map. And Mario World is the greatest thing. And the fact they included Mario Maker is fantastic, because it gives me a chance to play at least, you know, created Mario World levels that I can continue it on.
Yeah,
it is the first video game where I remember going to a friend's house who had a Super Nintendo, and I played Super Mario World. And I was blown away. It was like, it was probably one of the ghost houses. The ghost houses. It's the first introduction to the goddamn ghost houses. And they're fantastic. There's like, it's a puzzle. There's like several ways to leave each one. And I remember like going home and like getting like Duplos and Legos and trying to recreate like, like platform things of Mario Brothers and just being like, this, you know, this is incredible.
Wow.
It blew my mind. And it is a game that I have like played on emulators and then bought on the Wii. And I'm like tooth and nail trying to talk myself out of buying it on the 3DS just out of principle, because I've already owned it like four times.
Yaza.
But it's
okay, so it is probably no arguments from probably either of us, I guess.
I have not, so I grew up not with Nintendo machines. Super Mario World was one of the games that I could not watch, could not, like, didn't even want to engage with, because it made me so envious for people who had SNESs. So I didn't have a SNES, and if I bought a SNES, like I've played it since on, I think, Virtual Console on the Wii or something like that.
Sure.
But I still haven't played enough of it. So I think probably playing Mario Maker made me want to go back and play. This is my biggest blind spot when it comes to video games, is the early Mario stuff. But I remember Mario World being like, oh, Jesus Christ, this thing looks... I mean, you're right, it still looks unbelievable today. Dennis, I'm guessing you play the crap out of this as well.
Yeah, like, so I think Super Meat Boy is probably absolutely one of my favorite games of the last decade.
I love that that's the game that it's going to jump. Yeah, that's perfect.
But I think it's actually really fair. And I think if we had Team Meat in the room, they'd probably agree with it. They'd probably say as well that there's probably no Super Meat Boy without Super Mario World. It's such a phenomenally perfect platforming game. Like, I'll say right now, say I could never play another game in my life, I would probably take Super Meat Boy. I know that's not something you'd agree with. This is the subjective side of the list, but the objective side to the list is that Super Mario World is just a vitally important game to how we think of Nintendo, how we think of platforming, and it is still a perfect game.
All right. Yeah, number one, yeah?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, there you go. Super Meat Boy gets knocked down. That means that three of the top games at the moment are Nintendo games. We've Mario World on top, Meat Boy second, and Mario Strikers Charge. Sorry, I take it back. Two of them are Mario games.
Correct.
They know how to make a good game.
Strap goes to Super Mario World for now. Mario World holds a strap.
Big Sar 89 really mixing up the list here. And his last one, which should also be quite interesting, came out in 2005, a sequel to a genre-defining game. This is Call of Duty 2. So a little bit of a refresher maybe on 2. So Call of Duty obviously was the Medal of Honor folks sort of splitting off. And this is Zampella and West and founding Infinity Ward, and then creating the sort of next generation of important first-person shooters. So Call of Duty is the one that obviously has like a lot of the very memorable levels. It's the one where you drop in and Stalingrad near the end, the flag with the Reichstag, and getting your what is it, your rifle, and the other person gets a clip. I think it was the game that opened with you in the 101st Airborne dropping into Normandy. Fantastic game. Call of Duty 2, on the other hand, had the D-Day missions and stuff in it. It wasn't the Medal of Honor ones we know from before, but it did have the beach landings in it. But the reason Call of Duty 2, I guess, was significant, I think people don't remember it as much as the first one, and I don't necessarily think the campaign was as good, but it was the first one that sort of got onto that generation of consoles. So the Xbox 360 had a very good Call of Duty 2. When I worked in GameStop, it was one of the highest selling games, because we were like, oh my god, it's, you know, the 360 is really good at doing all these first-person games, but a lot of the big first-person games hadn't like come out yet, so people were sort of hungry for them around launch. And I think Call of Duty 2 was a launch game. I might be wrong for the Xbox 360. So yeah, like, although, you know, people, there were so many amazing first-person shooters that came out on the console eventually, like Halo 3 and stuff. I think around that time, Call of Duty 2 was the one that was selling a lot, because it made a big impact. So I feel like your appreciation of this game very much depends on if you had already played, I mean, all the Medal of Honors and then Call of Duty 1. I feel like around this time, people were getting sick of World War 2.
Sure.
So for me, it wasn't a massive game necessarily.
Yeah.
You know.
Well, that's as well also, wasn't it, like, parallel to this, a lot of the Battlefield, like 1942s and Battlefields. Yeah. Yeah, the period piece games. I'm just wondering how... I'm guessing this predates Modern Warfare.
Oh, yeah.
Yes.
Because I was wondering, like, how far ahead before they jumped to the future, or, like, the
modern
the
times,
the future.
Modern Warfare.
Yeah. Yeah, Call of Duty 3 was the one where I sort of got... Where it really... I think Call of Duty 2 for me was the beginning of the slump when it comes to World War 2 games. Call of Duty 3 was very much the slump. And then... Call of Duty 4 Modern Warfare is when they dragged it into the future. And we had World at War was in there as well, but that was kind of more...
Okay.
Was it? No, it wasn't Vietnam. Where was it? Pacific War? Maybe?
Not sure.
Maybe Korean War or something?
Oh, I always forget.
Kind of parallel to that, I have a kind of an interestingly different take on it, whereas I think COD 2 is actually sandwiched in between probably the two best World War 2 games. I think COD, obviously Medal of Honor is great and all, but I think when COD 1 came along, the whole world was like, this is how modern kind of shooters will be. This is really great. It also, like, it was technically marvelous. So, like, all that COD series has always actually been pretty good on that side of things. COD 3, I think, absolutely agreed that people were jaded and there was fatigue around these games, and there had been Soldier of Fortune, kind of Wolfenstein games that had kind of vaguely been in around there, obviously with a kind of supernatural element, and then Medal of Honors, and then there's probably a couple of others that we can't remember that got lost in the shuffle. But I think COD 3, I particularly remember as being just an incredible game. I think I was able to suspend my fatigue of the genre for how gloriously brilliant COD 3 was. Whereas COD 2, I think, is a very, very good game, and I don't know. I feel like, for me, it would probably go under COD 1 or COD 3 if they were eventually to turn up on this list.
Right. Yeah. So, difference to what I was saying, but I feel like we have the same sentiments where there were, Call of Duty 2 was a good game in a series that was often tremendous. So it never, like, the most significant thing for me for it is that it was a competent Xbox 360 shooter coming out of the, you know, Xbox and PlayStation 2, which I think were a lot more, you know, especially if you're a PC gamer coming from that side, that they didn't particularly play very well. All right, where do you think this is going?
Like, here's, like, a few times I've tried to put things above City of Heroes and there's been a little bit of pushback, but I think personally I'd have nearly no doubt, because this is a very good game, where City of Heroes is a interesting game and kind of a moment in time, but I wouldn't stand over saying City of Heroes is a really, really good game, whereas I think Call of Duty 2 was.
Right. Yeah, I'm in that same range as well. I'm wondering about Spyro.
Yeah, I think it can probably pop above that, personally.
I'm fine with that too. I think, again, for what it, again, as you've both pointed out, as of right now, especially, it doesn't stand out. There are other games in the series and, you know, rivals that do it very well, but it still did it very well. Like, it's almost a shame that that game came out when it did, because of what it did do, what it, you know, the audiences it reached. But it's probably better than Spyro and City of Heroes.
What about Star Wars Episode 1 Podracer?
Might be, actually.
There's an argument. Definitely an argument there to put above it. It definitely doesn't go above Crash Bandicoot.
No.
But it could be in between those two.
I mean, again, I could probably go above Podracer. I mean,
I feel like Call of Duty 2 doesn't do enough. Like, it's not it's not enough of a, like, it's standing on the shoulders of giants, right?
And at the feet of some stuff that's to come, you know?
Yeah.
It's
yeah.
not quite in that range. Okay, I think we put it behind Podracer, above Spyro.
But again, just as a final argument for it, and I'm just playing devil's advocate here. I sort of really don't have a dog in this fight. Maybe COD is just dealing with little brother syndrome, that it just has a lot to live up to, and it's not going to do that, and that's going against it. But while it is, as we found out yesterday in a Danny fun fact, Star Wars Episode 1 is the best, or say the highest grossing sci-fi racer. Highest grossing and best are two, you know, two very different things. Even in terms of racers, I think it's a lot of fun. We include the arcade thing. I've talked myself out. Behind Star Wars.
Okay,
no, it's just trying to think.
Silence.
Okay, is it above Spyro? I feel like I want to put it under Spyro. I don't know.
Well, like, yeah, really, we do get into. Okay, I'm willing to do that, and that to be the end of this discussion. If we put it behind City of Heroes, or in front of City of Heroes, behind Spyro, the only, like, and another thing that's important to talk about, even though I said it was the end of the discussion, is that there are probably at least three Call of Duties that will go above it.
Yeah.
If they get called out. So, yeah, that should probably be considered.
Okay. All right. I'm happy with that. So it's above City of Heroes, underneath Spyro the Dragon. It slots in at number 7 on our list, on our Tournament of Lies. Okay, I think we've got time for 3 more.
Okay.
Just want to break into them. I mean, you can never tell, because it depends on if we've actually played them or not. But okay, so first one in here, these three are from Yomidori Iro. The first game in here, a game that I love, I actually got a poster of it right there on the wall, Transistor. This came out a couple years back, Supergiant Games. Came out on PlayStation 4, came out on PC as well. The sequel to Bastion. Wonderful game. Big fan of this game personally. I actually reviewed it for GameSpot as well. No, I didn't review it for GameSpot. Did I? Let's look up the GameSpot review for Transistor and see who reviewed it. I really should remember this. I haven't reviewed that many games at all. And I really like this game probably because I didn't... No, Carolyn Pettit did. Okay, so it wasn't me. Carolyn liked it as well, 8 out of 10. But I didn't really like Bastion, or I didn't really play much Bastion, so I think Transistor does a lot of the same things Bastion does, but it really like hit home for me. Have you guys played it?
No, not at all. Not a minute.
I'm actually sort of bummed it's already here, because this is a game is on my list of many games to play. Just from what I've perceived of it, the art style, how it plays, and just basing it off Bastion, it looks beautiful.
We could always put this in the Purgatory of Lies. I prefer, it would be better if we had more people had played it.
Yeah.
So, Dennis, are you interested in, have you played it? Are you interested in
playing it? I haven't, and I absolutely would be. I love Bastion, and I certainly own Transistor on several platforms.
Yeah.
That's
Can we throw this into Purgatory?
Yeah.
Like you do Sunset Overdrive, we play Transistor.
Okay,
perfect.
Well,
yeah.
We can meet in
that. That sounds good, because otherwise we're going to get in a situation where only one of us has played a bunch of these games and we just doesn't seem holistic enough, so
cool.
Yeah, we never played them. This is like a good excuse to, and I suppose for anyone as well who's watching who maybe has Transistor, it's one of those games I feel like a lot of people bought and they never found a time for. So maybe this is a good excuse for you to, and we're not recording the third episode for a couple of weeks, so you've got a bit of time to do this as well. So okay, that goes in Purgatory. The next game I played a bit of, let's see, The Witcher 1. How are you guys on this one?
Zero.
I've played a little bit.
I played a little
so poorly.
Witcher 3.
God, did it age poorly.
Yeah.
But it's got such a huge following as well. This is one maybe where our feelings towards it will not be representative of other people who love this game.
When you say it's aged poorly, like, do you just mean graphics or like the game? Like, what exactly?
In every way,
I think
it's aged poorly.
Okay,
it's graphically, it looks not too. I mean, you go back and play Assassins of Kings now, the second Witcher game, and even that is like they patched the controls on that one pretty significantly because it was a mess of like Witcher 1 feels like a really badly controlled version of Dark. I hate referencing Dark Souls, but like it's that type of difficult combat, but the controls were not great. You really had to struggle against that game to see all the cool stuff, which was all the story stuff and all the like min-maxing of statistics and stuff. So I feel like, I mean, I think Witcher 2 is a far better game than Witcher 1, and I feel like Witcher 3 is a much different game to the two of those, and
okay.
It's my personal favorite, but it's like a sidestep from the first two games.
Okay.
I don't know. Like, I'm sure there were some people who loved playing the original Witcher because it was complex in that sort of Dungeons and Dragons-y way. But fuck me, man, that game is like, you could not play that game today. It would,
because it's interesting you even say that, because I remember when like Witcher 2 came out, it won a lot of awards. Like, it won Game of the Year on several things, and they loved it and how it looked. And I know Witcher 3 last year.
Yeah.
Absolutely blew up and ran. Like, and I played like a hair of Witcher 3. And then suddenly got swept away and didn't get a chance to play it and didn't really go back to it. But it'll be interesting to see if, even if you're saying like, it's just an interesting point, because like if Witcher 2 is already getting a little dated, I wonder how it's going to be for Witcher 3.
Yeah, Witcher 2, you go back and play, because they made it for consoles. It was the first one as well that eventually, I think 2 years later, it came out on consoles, Witcher 2, and that was sort of the impetus for them fixing. So if you go back and play Witcher 2 now on PC, they've patched a lot of the rough edges out, and they actually like, they put a tutorial in, like the game is so much easier because they basically changed the first like 10% of the game. But the first game is like, I went back last year and played it,
same,
before we went to Poland, before Witcher 3, right?
Well, so I didn't go to Poland, but
right, similar kind of reason, right? It's just like, get some sort of foundation for Geralt's third jaunt. And it's not, like, to me it exists in the Hellgate London range of, this was a really good idea, it's doing a lot of things very interestingly, but it never came together.
Yeah, like, I honestly think it's okay, so it's genre kind of thing, but like, it would be easier for any of us to play Gex right now. You would be genuinely annoyed if you install on you know, GOG Galaxy or whatever that's called. It's GOG Galaxy.
Yeah.
And you install Witcher 1, which I did last year, and start trying to play through it, you know, you start hitting the wall pretty quick. Whereas, you know, anybody can play any sort of acceptable side-scrolling game. Now, that maybe isn't fair on it. It shouldn't be completely hammered over, you know, being a game of its time. Like Morrowind is probably a similar, comparable game. And
yeah.
I think it's aged a lot better. And it's certainly, like, if I had to play one of the two, it would be so much easier for me to just boot up Morrowind.
Yeah, you're right. There's, like, that whole era of third-person fantasy open-world games. I mean, The Witcher was almost coming off the back of a bunch of those. And first-person, I guess, when you talk about the Elder Scrolls stuff. But, yeah, like, all those games that sort of came out in the 90s, the online ones and the offline ones as well. Like, I feel like Witcher was kind of trying to do a take on that, but it just, yeah, I mean, I it feels like one of those games. It doesn't feel like a new version of that. It feels like one of those sort of old games. So I don't, yeah, I find it hard to go to bat on this one. I have a feeling this might end up being in the parole board. I have a feeling there might be a bunch of people who love The Witcher who are going to get on us for this, but to me, I think it rests above Hellgate London and under Gex.
That was my placement if I was going to shout one out. Yeah,
that's fine for me. Right. And I just, if it does make the parole board, tough shit, because we're not playing it. I'm just going to leave it there.
That'll be a real hard one.
Yeah, you're just wasting your breath.
Okay, and the last one then, I guess, on Mr. Eero's list here is a game that I haven't played and one that I actually have been wanting to as well. It's Papa EO.
Haven't played it.
It's parole board as well.
It looks so sweet. It looks so sweet and cute and gorgeous and fun.
It's available on Steam, $15 here. So
let's go as far as to look at my Steam catalog and see do I have it. I think I do.
Yes, this is a thing that you will learn about Dennis, is that he owns every video game ever made.
Papo and Yo, I have it there, sitting there. Game purchased in 2014.
I think, I think it's a Brazilian developed, I want to say. Somewhere non-English speaking, and it's sort of a parable for some sort of relationship between, I believe, the developer and their alcoholic father, I think. Is the sort of subtext that's going on. So apparently it's like, it's you're this child and then this sort of monster that's kind of nice to you sometimes but then gets a bit crazy and you have to placate it or something, like an abusive sort of parental relationship, right? So apparently that's the sort of the subtext of it. It's not a spoiler or anything, but that might be cool. I'm actually looking forward to playing that. That sounds great to me.
Cool. Yeah, well, I can definitely... I'll bring my laptop with me and a controller, and I will play those.
Ruin your holiday.
No, it's 36 hours travel each way. I have to do something.
Oh, I'm not going to Hobbit in honey. I'm just going to be pappy.
Awesome. All right, well, I guess that's episode 2. Done and dusted. Thank you so much for listening and for watching. Dennis Walsh, thank you for hanging out. Dude, enjoy your time in Hobbiton. Take plenty of pictures. I'm sure you'll be tweeting your exploits and whatnot.
Look forward to it.
Enjoy. Have a great time. James, were you doing anything much for the next couple of weeks down in Hollywood?
Just hanging out, surfing, hitting them waves, hanging with some babes.
Do you ever surf?
Tune in next time to hear my surfing adventure.
What happens when you bring girls back to your bedroom and there's a picture of Henry Winkler jumping the shark above your bed?
They normally just, I just don't reference it. I just sort of leave it there. And if it comes up,
it's huge.
It's a work in progress. Yeah, it's pretty big. And that's a problem. It's a work in progress. I want to get, like, if anyone actually has a lead on where I can get cheap Baroque frames, they're about like 5 feet by 30 inches.
You just have to get that framed in a framing place.
Yeah, I want to get it framed. I want to get it super framed.
Do you mean Baroque?
Yeah, Baroque. Baroque frame. Like, I want a real cordial thing for the frame, and then it's going to go on the wall.
Nice.
And it's still a work in progress because I'm not going to pay. I found frames, but they're like $200-$300.
Yeah,
that's a little too far for the joke.
We got some
for a cheap bastard like me.
If you're bored doing that, you've got Sunset Overdrive, which I guess I'll be biting the bullet on that one. We've got Transistor and Papa EO in the Purgatory of Lies. If you are listening or watching right now and you want to join in our conversation with that, feel free to play it. We will be taking user feedback on those games as well. We'll get you guys involved. And I guess as it stands now, reading through the list, we'll just talk about the top 5. In 5th, Star Wars Episode 1 Podracer. 4th is Crash Bandicoot. 3rd, Mario Strikers Charged. Super Meat Boy. They're both from last week. And a new number 1 this week. might be a while before we get this one kicked off. Super Mario World. Thank you so much for watching and listening. Make sure you subscribe on iTunes. Make sure you hit that subscribe button on YouTube as well if you like the video version. The email address is atournamentoflies@gmail.com. If you have any games you want to give, suggest to us, send in your three there. We'll get to them. The list is big, but we're randomly going through it. So if we haven't gotten to yours, we may do so in the next one. But thank you so much for watching and listening, and we'll see you next time on a tournament of lies. Adios.